Well, good morning, everyone. Welcome to First Church of the Nazarene. It's a beautiful Sunday morning for Palm Sunday. Let's stand as we begin our worship this morning with All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name. All hail the power of Jesus' name. Let angels prostrate fall. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord.
Glad that you're here this morning and excited to worship again on this Palm Sunday. So thank you for being here this morning. Let's begin with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for your love for us and your care for us. Thank you for the ways that you walk with us through the challenges of this life. And this morning as we gather to worship, we remember our brothers and sisters in Egypt whose church was bombed this morning as they were coming to worship for Palm Sunday. And we remember our brothers and sisters around the world for whom coming to church is a very scary endeavor. And we thank you for the privileges that we have, but we do remember those who are suffering this morning. Father, as we come into this place this morning, we come with our minds full of stuff. There's a lot of details floating through our minds. And I just pray for your peace and your calm to settle over us. Help us to sense your presence and know that you are with us. Speak to each one of us the message that we need to hear today. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. And you may be seated. Well, a couple of announcements as we get started this morning. First of all, there is no PM service tonight, so no evening service tonight. Today, after the service, we're having a couples baby shower for Josh and Anna Rorta. And for the little baby, we don't know boy or girl yet, but we'll know in a month or so. And we're excited for them. So that'll be after the service in the gym. Easter lilies, if you would like to order an Easter lily, then those order forms are due today. We will place that order tomorrow. And the Easter lilies will be here next Sunday to decorate the sanctuary. And then after the service, you can take those home with you. And our Easter schedule for next week is in the bulletin. You can see that the breakfast, I believe, starts at... Who's got their bulletin out? Because I didn't even look. 8:30, that's what I thought. I just didn't want to say it if I hadn't verified it. So 8:30 for the breakfast. We'll have a great time with breakfast. The kids will have an Easter egg hunt. And then the morning worship service will start as normal at 10:30. So we're looking forward to a great time together as we worship next Sunday for Easter. All right. Well, today is Palm Sunday, and I'll read that passage of Scripture as a part of my message. But I encourage you to just remember the celebratory attitude as we sing and worship this morning. Let's stand together.
I see the King of Glory coming on the clouds with fire. The whole earth shakes. washing over all our sin. The people sing, the people sing. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna. Rising up to take their place with selfless faith, with selfless faith. I see a new revival stirring as we pray and seek. We're on our knees, we're on our it out. Hosanna. 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 Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna. Hosanna. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna. Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna. Cornerstone, let's sing it out this morning. My hope is built. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. When darkness seems to hide His face, I rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. My anchor holds within the veil. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. He is Lord, Lord of all. When He shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in Him be found, dressed in His righteousness alone, faultless stand before the throne. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. He is Lord, the Lord of all. As morning dawns and evening fades, You inspire songs of praise that rise from earth to touch Your heart and glorify Your name. Your name is a strong and mighty tower. Your name is a shelter like no other. Your name, let the nations sing it louder, 'cause nothing has the power to save but Your name. Jesus, in Your name we pray, come and fill our hearts today. Lord, give us strength to live for You and glorify Your name. Your name is
As we come into this place this morning, I know that we come in with the realities of life. And I know for some of us, this has been a phenomenal week, and we're really excited about some awesome things happening. For some of us, it's been a great week, but we're just flat out exhausted. For some of us this morning, we're really struggling with some tough stuff. But no matter where you're at this morning, we come before our great high priest, Jesus Christ, who invites us to come boldly before the throne of grace. To come before him knowing that no matter what we face, no matter what we're going through, he hears us, he loves us, and he cares. So we're going to sing through this chorus again, and as we do that, I just encourage you to prepare your hearts for prayer. Our altars are open. If you would like to come forward, if you would like special prayer, Pastor Larry and Meyer will be in the front. Take advantage of this opportunity. Come before Jesus Christ to know that he hears and that he responds.
Your name is a strong and mighty tower. Your name is a shelter like no other. Your name, let the nations sing it louder, 'cause your name.
Father, this morning as we come into this place, we are so thankful for your love for us. And we're so thankful for the fact that we can cry out to you in our times of trouble, in our times of need, in our times of exhaustion, and you hear us. And Father, this morning as we come together, I know that this is a difficult morning for many as we think about what has taken place in Egypt this morning as a church gathered to worship and a bomb goes off in the middle of the service. We lift up our brothers and sisters this morning. And Father, as we gather in this place this morning, some of us may feel like a bomb has gone off in our life this week. Things that were all settled and everything made sense, now all of a sudden things are chaotic and out of control. Father, wherever we're at today, whatever we're facing, whatever's going on, I pray that you will speak peace into each of our hearts. And we take a few moments now to lift up in this time of silent prayer those concerns that are weighing heavily upon our hearts. Father, thank you for your love for us. Thank you for your presence with us in the midst of the chaos. We recognize that as we enter this holy week, the week that we celebrate your coming into Jerusalem, the week that we celebrate your death, and most importantly, your rising again to life. I pray that you'll speak to each of our hearts and help us to hear from you this week. Speak to us through the circumstances of life. Speak to us through the friends that we acquaint ourselves with this week. Speak to us through the media that we take in. Help us to see you and your hand throughout this week. And we thank you for being a God who loves us and cares for us, who cares about the big picture and cares about spending eternity with us, but also who cares about the little pictures and the realities of each of our lives in each ongoing day. Father, there are many times that we find ourselves at a loss for what to say. And in such times, we find great comfort and great joy in praying together the prayer that your Son taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And you may be seated. Oh.
Let's stand together, can we? Revelation song. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain, and holy, holy is he. Sing a new song to him who sits on heaven's mercy seat. The creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. Clothe in rainbows of living color, flashes of lightning, rolls of thunder. Blessing and honor, strength and glory and power to you. The creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. The creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. Filled with wonder, awestruck wonder at the mention of your name. Jesus, your name is power, breath and living water, such a marvelous mystery. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With the creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore. Just our voices. Here we go. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With whole creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything. You are my may be seated.
Our ushers will come forward at this time. We'll continue to worship through the giving of our tithes and offerings. All right, could you pray for our offering this morning?
Lord, thank you for being with us in your Holy Spirit and for our fellowship together. Thank you for all that you do for everyone in this world every day in every way. Please bless our offering today. For all power, honor, praise, and glory is yours forever. Amen.
To our worship team this morning. Well, as I mentioned, today is Palm Sunday. And when we think of Palm Sunday, when I think of Palm Sunday, I typically think of one of those days of the year where we're on the same page as every other church in the world. Which, it's also one of those times of year where people start remembering church and thinking about Easter. And so the songs that we just sang together, the Revelation song in particular, as we think about what that's going to be like to gather around the throne in heaven with no worries on our minds, with no anxieties, with nothing going on, and to just be able to praise our God and our Creator. What a beautiful thought that is. I'm looking forward to that day. The text for this week in the book of Hebrews will allude to that portion or that reality of God being for us, or Jesus Christ being for us, a high priest, looking to that heavenly vision. But I want us to start this morning with the story of the parade. I don't know if you guys like to go to parades. I haven't been to a parade. We haven't been to a parade since we moved to Davenport, I don't think. In McCook, it was a whole lot easier because there were only like 10 streets in McCook, and the parade route was one street over from where we lived. So you just, when we think about the Palm Sunday or the procession, the triumphal entry, as we call it, Jesus is coming to Jerusalem, and he knows what he's coming for. He's coming because he knows that in a very few short days, he's going to be hanging on the cross. That's in his mind. It's been in his mind for quite some time. He's told his disciples this. He's told the whole gang that is traveling with them. But they don't get it. They're coming to Jerusalem. And they're excited because they think maybe this is the time when something is finally going to happen. Maybe this is when Jesus is going to finally step up, forget about healing all those goofy sick people, forget about teaching sermons and finally put his foot down and say, this is the time that I'm going to overthrow Rome and we are going to be free as a nation again. Enough with the chaos. That's the setup for the parade. As people come into Jerusalem, the whole nation is gathering for their celebration of Passover. And we celebrate this as a church holiday, but we celebrate it as a church holiday because they were celebrating it as a church holiday. All of the Jews, all the males were required to attend, but all of the, as many as could, would bring their families to Jerusalem for this time of worship together as a nation. And I want us to understand that in the entire gospel story, leading up to the crucifixion, which is the bulk of all four gospels, this is the only time that Jesus allowed his disciples or the crowds to worship him. Every other time that the crowds would start to reach out to worship, Jesus would run and disappear. He would move on to another village if the crowds got too excited. This is the only time in the gospel narratives prior to the crucifixion where Jesus allowed the crowds to worship him. Let's read together the passage from John's Gospel. The next day, the news that Jesus was on the way to Jerusalem swept through the city. A large crowd of Passover visitors took palm branches and went down the road to meet him. They shouted, "Praise God, blessings on the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hail to the King of Israel." Jesus found a young donkey and rode on it, fulfilling the prophecy that says, "Don't be afraid, people of Israel. Look, your king is coming, riding on a donkey's colt." His disciples didn't understand at the time that this was a fulfillment of prophecy, but after Jesus entered his glory, they remembered what had happened and realized that these things had been written about him. Many in the crowd had seen Jesus call Lazarus from the tomb, raising him from the dead, and they were telling others about it. And that is the reason that so many went out to meet him, because they had heard about his miraculous sign. The crowds that day had huge expectations. And I think when you go to a parade today, you have expectations. I can remember as a child going to a few parades, and I remember that I lived at least 20 miles from any parade routes. Only two stoplights between here and there, but 20 miles at least, because I grew up in the middle of nowhere. But the few times that I remember as a child going to parade, I had one expectation: candy. I wanted candy, because in my house we didn't have money to buy candy very often, so it was a real treat to get candy. When I've taken the girls to a parade, the expectation for them was candy, and for me was, let's stand far enough back that they don't get too much. But the crowds that had gathered this day, as they come into Jerusalem, had some pretty intense expectations. The lead up to this is that Jesus had healed the sick. They had witnessed as Jesus had healed many sicknesses. Jesus had fed the multitudes. They had watched as Jesus had taken the bread and fed thousands of people with just a few loaves of bread. They had watched or heard the story as Jesus calmed the storm. A raging storm, and Jesus just stood up and spoke, and all of a sudden it was calm as could be. And most recently, Jesus had raised the dead. John's Gospel relates that most of those who were gathered had either been there or heard the story of Jesus raising Lazarus from the dead. Now, let me ask you this question. Can you imagine what kind of a military leader it would be if your military leader could just speak the word and everybody who was sick or injured could be healed again and ready to fight? Can you imagine how awesome it would be as a military leader to not have to tote tons and tons of food to feed your troops, but just take five loaves for each day And then when it's time to eat, just have your military leader start passing out the food. Can you imagine how amazing it would be that weather would not be an issue if you were in the middle of a military campaign? Because your military leader could simply speak the word and the storms would be calm. Or if you knew the stories of the Old Testament, he could speak the word and a storm would come up. That'd be a great thing to have on your side, wouldn't it, if you were looking for a military leader? And then to have a military leader that if any of your soldiers were killed, he could simply say, come forth, and they would come back to life. From what the Jews in the audience that day had seen, if Jesus would just step into this role of being the military leader, they were absolutely invincible. What could you do against them? You kill them, he brings them back to life. You try to cut off the supply chain so they don't get food, he makes the food out of nothing. You try to play the weather, he can control the weather. He's perfect. He is the perfect military leader. And everybody gathered together there that day was waiting on a military leader. They were waiting on a military leader because they lived in absolute oppression. They lived in a culture where they were Jews, but they were under the control of the Romans. And the Romans exacted heavy, heavy tax burdens. And they allowed corrupt tax collectors who were Jewish citizens to exact whatever taxes they wanted. And the people felt like they were absolutely in a no-win situation. They were desperate for help. They were tired of being under the control of others. And they desperately wanted someone to step up and to free them from this oppression. And Jesus was the perfect guy. But Jesus coming into that parade had different expectations. His expectation or his priority was getting himself to the cross by the end of this week, for paying the price for the sins of all, not just the Jewish people. His priority was permanent victory over sin. He wasn't interested in short-term military gains. He would have been the absolute perfect military leader, but the truth is that Jesus knew the history of the nation of Israel better than they knew it. And he knew that he could step up as a military leader and free them from the Roman oppression, just like he had worked to free them from the Egyptians and the Midianites and the Philistines, and on and on and on the list goes. God had freed the people of Israel from their oppression numerous times. In fact, if you're ever just wanting to see how sinful they were and how many times it had to happen, just read the book of Judges, because it's like every other chapter is, here we go again. And Jesus knew that he could work to free these people who were following in this parade. He could give them what they wanted. And within 20 years, they'd blow it again, because that's what they always did. He had a bigger goal in mind than just the military gains, because he had observed the corruptibility of humans for generations. He knew that we needed something more. Jesus knew that we needed a great high priest. So let's look back to the book of Hebrews and what we read this week in Hebrews. Hebrews chapter 4, starting with verse 14. So then, since we have such a great high priest who has entered heaven, Jesus the Son of God, let us hold firmly to what we believe. Because this high priest of ours understands our weaknesses, for he faced all of the same testings that we do, yet he did not sin. So let us come boldly to the throne of our gracious God. There we will receive his mercy, and we will find grace to help us when we need it the most. This is what was on Jesus' mind, not the applause of the crowds. I mentioned that Jesus allowed the people to worship him. The only reason that Jesus allowed them to worship him was not because he said they're finally getting it, but because, as Matthew tells us, it put the whole city in a tizzy. And all of a sudden, people started paying attention to the fact that Jesus was in town, which was going to help him end up on the cross by Friday. Every other time that Jesus comes to Jerusalem, he comes kind of incognito. He's hiding. He's coming in such a way that nobody knows he's there. And he just shows up in the temple to teach, but then he quietly disappears. But Jesus had a mission. Jesus had a goal in mind that was not looking at the applause of the people on this day, but was looking forward to the cross coming on Friday. Now understand that I'm not saying that Jesus doesn't want us to worship him, because I firmly believe that he does. And I firmly believe in the need for us as the people of God to spend time in worship. I just want us to understand that Jesus' motive in allowing them to worship him there was because it would get the attention of the Romans. It would get the attention of the Jewish leaders. And it would accomplish his goal of the cross by Friday. Now, the role of the high priest in Jewish society, and we just read much of how this was set up in the book of Exodus, was to offer the sacrifice of atonement once a year. The high priest, and we even read about all the fancy clothes that he got to wear in the book of Exodus, the high priest would go into the temple or tabernacle one time a year and offer the sacrifice that led to the forgiveness of all of the people of Israel, to represent humanity in matters of the divine. He was the go-between in the Jewish system that would come to God and present to God the needs of the people. And he would share God with the people to represent humanity in the affairs of the world. He was not just a spiritual leader in the role in Israel. He was to be a political leader as well. But this position had gone very bad because of a hunger for power. I know you can't imagine that anybody would ever get into that position where they would just be hungry for power. It happened then just the same as it happens today. Political corruption. If you think our system of government is corrupt, and I do, my political stance is that diapers and politicians should be changed frequently and for the same reason. But as corrupt as I tend to think our political system is, the high priest, the political corruption in the system of Jesus' day was much, much, much worse. Because rather than being for the people or working with the people, the high priest viewed himself as above the people. And the high priest's position is actually confusing because as you read the Old Testament, there's only supposed to be one high priest. But yet in the stories that we read of the trial of Jesus, there's two. How can there be two? Because it was a lifelong position. You didn't relinquish your position as high priest until you were dead. Unless you were so corrupt that the government would replace you, which is what happened. But the man who was replaced was able to weasel his son-in-law into the position after him. So he still maintained control, even though his son-in-law had the position. And it's corrupt. And it's tied into the giving in to Herod whatever Herod wanted, the Jewish, not really Jewish king, but they kept Herod in control. And then after his death, it was the group who would finagle and get their way. And they didn't care about people. The high priest didn't do his job of offering the sacrifice once a year. In fact, Josephus tells us that at the time of Christ, that the room in the sanctuary, the Holy of Holies, where he was supposed to go to make this sacrifice once a year, was empty. It was a facade. There was nothing there. And the priesthood, the position of high priest, had gone absolutely corrupt. But Jesus enters the picture. Jesus did not come to offer atonement once a year. Jesus came to be the atonement for our sins. The high priest didn't do his job. Jesus came to take his job away. The high priest didn't come to represent humanity to the divine. He came to reconcile humanity to the divine. He didn't come to say, "Let me tell you about God." He came to say, "I am God, and let me show you what that means." He didn't come to represent humanity in the affairs of the world. He came to redeem the world. His goal was not to just keep the peace or to plead a perspective. His goal was to be the answer, to redeem those who were lost, to reach out to those who were forsaken and alone. Jesus did not come hungry for power. He gave up his power to die for our sins. Do you realize how hard that would have been for Jesus? To give up the power that could have kept him from feeling any human pain. At a moment's notice, he didn't even have to speak a word. He could have thought a thought. And he chose not to. He chose to give up his power so that he could die for our sins. He wasn't corrupt politically. He lived without sinning. There were no skeletons in his closet to dig up. He wasn't above the people. He came to bring accessibility to the people. He came so that we could come before him without having to go through anybody else. He came to provide the answer so that you didn't have to worry about would the priests be corrupt or would they be honest in the fulfillment of their tasks and their responsibilities. He came to say that I am available to you anytime you want. And you don't have to call me, the pastor, to get to God. Back at the parade, the people threw a parade because they wanted a military leader. But Jesus let them worship because he knew what they really needed. Today we celebrate that Jesus came and became what they needed and not what they wanted. I think it's a profound thought to recognize that that Palm Sunday is not about Jesus getting what he wanted. It's him allowing them to worship him only because it gave them what they truly needed. Not what they wanted. And I would say that we need to be cautious of making the same mistake. I think it's too easy for us in our culture, in our comfort, in our humanity, in our corruptness, in our selfishness, it's easy for us to take Jesus and twist him to make him what we want him to be. And we do it all too often. We take Jesus and we use Jesus to get what we want rather than accepting him for who he truly is. Now, were the people of Israel wrong to want to be freed from the oppression that they were under? Not at all. God does not create us to live under oppression. He did not create us. And that's very clear in the book of Exodus, that God hears the cries of those who are in oppression. But the short-term pain that we feel every time God redeemed that and rescued the people of Israel, they got themselves right back into it. Why? Because there was a greater pain at work, the pain of sin, the reality of sin at work in our world. And that's what Jesus came to say. I'm going to not just free your nation, I'm going to free you as individuals. I'm going to give you the freedom, the peace, the life as individuals, rather than just rescuing your nation so that you can get into trouble once again. I found this quote this morning by one of my favorite authors, N.T. Wright. He says, the strong point to which we come, which opens the main central section of the letter running from now to the end of chapter 7, that's Hebrews, is that Jesus has fulfilled the ancient promise of God that he would eventually send his people a great high peace who would do in perpetuity and perfectly what the regular priesthood symbolized, but could only do in part and imperfectly. Throughout the nation of Israel, from the moment that the priesthood was given at the base of Mount Sinai, the priests would come and go as to whether they would be authentic or whether they would be corrupt. And the story that the author of the Hebrews is building is that Jesus came to be that answer. That there would never more be room for a corrupt priest that would keep you from getting what you need. But he himself, Jesus Christ himself, would be for you what you need in perfectly symbolizing the priesthood. Which leads me to the book of Malachi and the passage that for the last 3 years, I have read at least once a day. I have it on the wall of my office at home. I have it in my office here. This passage has been floating in my head for a long time. And it says, the purpose of my covenant with the Levites, the priests, was to bring life and peace. And that is what I gave them. This required reverence from them, and they greatly revered me and stood in awe of my name. But then it goes on to say, and it says before, that they just wouldn't fulfill that role over time. They kept messing up, and they kept, instead of leading the people and giving them what they needed from the priesthood, instead of bringing the people life and peace, they would bring the people to death and turmoil. And for me, as I've tried to wrestle with what am I called to as a pastor, because the role of pastor has changed drastically, radically in the last 20 years. So as I've wrestled with this question, as Janelle and I have wrestled with this question, what are we supposed to do in the church? And this verse has been our foundation. That's why it's on the wall at home, and that's why it's on the wall in my office, or my speaker in my office. I believe that the role that I have is to help people find life and peace. But I can only do that in limited form. But I believe that that's what Jesus came to bring to you, to me, is true life and true peace. Jesus is the great high priest, can do what the Levitical priest failed to do over and over. And that is to bring life and peace to those who would seek after Jesus. Jesus fulfilled the role of the head Levite. Much of the argument in the book of Hebrews is that, can he do that? Can he be that because he came from the tribe of Judah, not the tribe of Levi? Jesus fulfilled the role of the head Levite. And Jesus desires to bring us life and peace. And so the question I have for us this morning is, can we accept the gift that God gives us of life and peace? Now, it's important to understand that when Jesus came to bring life and peace, it doesn't mean that, life is going to then be easy. Because does anybody have a really easy life? Has anybody had, you know, a 10-year period where everything was just rosy and everything went the way that you wanted it to go? No. We all deal with stuff. We all have our challenges. But what Jesus came to do was to give us peace on the inside. That no matter what's going on in life around us, no matter how chaotic life may seem, no matter who our president is, no matter what's going on in the world around us, that we can have peace in the midst of the chaos. That we can have hope when it seems like it's all falling apart. Because we have such a great high priest, let us hold firmly to what we believe. Our worship team would come as we prepare to close. Our closing song this morning is the song "We Believe," which just reaffirms our belief, our faith. I think it's so easy for us to get caught up in the commercialized Jesus. To get caught up in the Jesus that just does for you what you want Him to do. And I hope you understand this morning, when I say Jesus came to give us life and peace, Jesus did not come to give us life on easy street. He came to give us peace in the midst of the life that we have. He came to help us to see the beauty in the life that we live, rather than always wanting the life that somebody else had. Because if you knew their life, it's not as grand as you think it is. But it's easy for us to see what others have. It's easy for us to resent what happens to us and to miss the gift that Jesus came to bring us. As the great high priest who will never fail you, the gift of life and peace. Let's stand together as we sing "Together We Believe."
In this time of desperation, when all we know is doubt and fear, there is only one foundation. We believe, we believe in this generation. When all is dark, you help us see. There is only one salvation. We believe, we believe, we believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and He's coming back again. We believe. So let our faith be more than anthems, greater than the songs we sing. And in our weakness and temptations, we believe. He's coming back again. Let the lost be found and the dead be raised in the here and now. Let love and faith and the church live loud. Our God will say, we believe, we believe. And the gates of hell will not prevail, for the power of God has torn the veil. Now we know your love will never fail. We believe, we believe. We believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and He's coming back. He's coming back again. He's coming back again.
Privilege that you give us of being your children. Thank you for being the great high priest and allowing us to come to you without having to go through a human that could be corrupt. Thank you for being the atonement for our sin rather than requiring us to sacrifice an animal to receive that atonement. Thank you for the hope that you bring us in this life and in this world. The peace that says that no matter what is going on around us, you are with us. And Father, no matter what we're facing today, help us to sense and know that life and peace that you came to give. And as we approach this holy week leading up to Easter, remind us over and over again that your willingness to die for us was so that we could truly experience life and peace. Now and for all eternity. In Jesus' name we pray, amen, and you are dismissed.